now to the book of Ephesians chapter 6. Starting in verse number 10, when you shall have found, say amen and stand to your feet to honor the reading of this portion of the Bible. Indeed, God is praiseworthy. Rising of the sun to the going down of the sun. Ephesians chapter 6, starting in verse number 10, reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible, you'll find these words: finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present age, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness, as shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel. With all of these, take the shield of faith with which you'll be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Back up to verse 12. I believe King James says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. I want to preach for about 15 minutes today on the subject, who is our enemy? Or who is the enemy? Who is the enemy? Let's go to God in prayer. Father, where I am, you wrong. What I know, you taught me. What I have, you gave. What I am, Lord, you made. Lord, I'm depending on you. Can't do nothing until you come. This is your servant's prayer, asking in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Turn and ask somebody, neighbor, do you know who's the enemy? Yeah, turn and tell somebody, neighbor, I'm not your enemy. Amen. Who is the enemy? Well, Charlotte made the news this week in a really big way. Beginning on Tuesday afternoon with the shooting of Keith Lamont Scott and the subsequent protest marches, Charlotte, North Carolina has led the news story of every major outlet. While attending our regional meeting in Rochester, I watched in my room the marches, the interviews, press conferences, and sadly the looting and the violence that has been the reality for Charlotte last week. And I feel with mixed emotions the reality for days to come. While we gather here this morning for worship, Charlotte, the Queen City, is in a state of emergency. The National Guard is patrolling uptown. The business and cultural life of the city is interrupted. Tourism and subsequently the local economy that affects folk like us is riveted, and people with the words of modern day are asking the question, what's going on? Charlotte, the Queen City, is now an occupied municipality. The presence of troops on the ground evokes the image of a city in the midst of a war. A city that is engaged in an intense battle whose outcome is up for grabs. We are now in so many ways like Fallujah in Iraq and Aleppo in Syria. We are in a battle, and the question which must be asked and answered is, who is the enemy? The definition of the enemy is part of any successful battle plan. In the book, The Art of War, we are told that we are to know the enemy and we are to know ourselves. Going, reverence, into a battle or fighting in a battle without a clear and definitive understanding of the enemy is like someone diving into a deep lake without knowing how to swim. While commended for bravery, one must be reprimanded for foolishness. Without knowing the enemy, we waste resources, drain morale, lose lives, fail to inspire, and prolong the battle. Knowing the enemy is step one in any successful battle plan. The Apostle Paul, the writer of our text today, understood this simple and important truth. Paul, in the book of Ephesus, Ephesians, writes to the church of Ephesus, and he begins waxing eloquent about the grace of a loving God. Paul now, like a skilled orator, is bringing his arguments to a close, and Paul, in the book of Ephesians, at the close, calls us to action. Paul reaches into the imagery of the Roman military complex, and in particular, the typical Roman soldier, to make his point. Paul calls for the Jesus community of Ephesus to remain strong in spite of the challenges they had and surely would experience. Paul had no room for superficial and cotton candy type of Christianity so popular and practiced today. Being a member of the Jesus community, following in the steps of Jesus, meant that the same struggles and opposition awaits all who dare to identify with Jesus. Jesus and his message of expansive grace requires dogged determination and sustained strength in order to make it. So Paul uses the imagery of a soldier in the Roman army, the strongest military power of Paul's day, to tell fellow members of the Jesus community what must be done if they're going to make it. Paul tells them, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand and to hold out, to be able to be victorious against all the evil plots and schemes that are coming your way. It is at this point that Paul defines for his audience who is the enemy. Paul declares that in this battle, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. This is not the enemy. For Paul, the enemy is rulers and authorities, cosmic powers of this present darkness, against spiritual forces in heavenly places. Yes, Paul makes plain that for the Jesus community of Ephesus, and by implication the universal Jesus community, the fight is against entrenched power already against us. For Paul, that was the enemy, principalities and powers. In the battle with which we are now confronted, Who is the enemy? About this, we must be clear. We need to know, name, and identify the enemy that must be defeated if the beloved community can be actualized in our lifetime. I fear on this point, there is not clarity. I have heard many identify the enemy in ways that will not bring about community, but only widen the divide. I have witnessed persons identify the enemy in ways that add more fuel to an already raging fire. Preach, Clifford Matthews. I hear that many in the rush for spotlight and celebrity are allowing the words to become weapons. Who is the enemy? I want to tell you, the enemy is systemic and institutional racism. This is the enemy with which we must battle. What is institutional racism? Institutional racism describes racism which is structured into the very structures of our society. It occurs when organizations or institutions and government even discriminate either deliberately or indirectly against certain groups of people to limit their rights. It is racism that reflects the cultural assumptions of a dominant group so that the practices of that group are seen as the norm to which all other groups must conform. It is about advantage for some and disadvantage and marginalization for others. That is the enemy with which we must fight. This past week, we saw a supporter from a major campaign, let me just say the Trump campaign, a volunteer coordinator in the city, state of Ohio, say that racism did not exist until Barack Obama became president. She said, in her words, that it was only when he became president that racism showed up. She went on to say that any African American that has not bettered themselves and taken advantage of the opportunity since the late black early 1970s, it's their fault they are where they are. We heard a member of the United States House of Representatives who said he was a friend of the African American community say that people are angry because black folk don't have the success that white folk do. Let's be clear about this. They're not bad folk who said that. They are just folk who really fail to understand systemic racism. Systemic racism is that which has continued to make progress for our folk somewhat hard and difficult. This past week, I was part of a group about race matters for juvenile justice, and they talked about the monopoly game and how that shows us the power of structural or systemic racism. It's all about a group coming to the table to play monopoly. And this group is allowed to play and buy all the land and the pieces and the property, railroads on the board. After most of the property is gone and most of the bank is already spent, they then invite another group to join the game. This group now has access to the game. They can roll the dice, they can move around the board, they can do whatever everybody else in Group A has done. So to access is no longer the problem. The problem is that once they come to the board, most of the property is already gone. Once they come to the board, most of the stuff is no longer available. And so now when you come to the board, if you land on that board, when you first started the game, that board was no problem at all. But in the game, Biltmore had hotels on the property. When you landed on Biltmore, it could break the bank. That shows you how powerful systemic racism is. It manifests itself in ways that limits opportunity, not only in our country, but it comes to education, but also housing and health. It makes it hard for folk who came to the table late in the day to be successful. That is the enemy about which we must fight. That is the enemy that tells us that we have to stay where we are. And if we're not where we are, that it is nothing but our own fault. I must confess to you that I struggled with this. Yes, I did. Because I was brought up to believe if you work hard, and you do the right thing, you can be successful even in America. And I still believe that. And I want to tell you that we have to work harder than everybody else just to maintain what we have. And when times get hard, we are the first ones to lose what we have. I want to let you know in the Great Recession, I am part of that group. We lost our wealth, and we're still trying to climb out of the hole we found ourselves in. We came to the game of the board game late, and now we have to work twice as hard just to get back to being even. I want to let you know that is the enemy that we must fight against. It is systemic, structural, institutional racism. That is the enemy. And on this we must be clear. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. White Americans are not our enemy. Y'all better say amen to that. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Chief Kerr Putney is not the enemy. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Individual police officers who swore to uphold the law and who sacrificed daily that we might live in a safe society, they are not the enemy. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. We must find a way to call for reform to the justice system without demonizing the rainbow army of those who protect us even while we are sound asleep. This is the enemy. Let us not be naive and think this enemy is not strong. To be honest with you, the more I encounter it, the more I do not want to. It is a beast that prowls. It is a serpent that strikes. It is a monster with which one cannot reason. In the face of this enemy, where is our hope? At times like these, hope seems to be fleeting. It is in these times we feel overwhelmed, and if we're not careful, depression will set in. Am I right about that? This is what happened to American civil rights leader Frederick Douglass. Douglass was in Boston, Massachusetts at an event, and it became clear that depression had set in. He had become disillusioned that after all the work to end slavery, it still existed. Looked like effort did not lead to progress. What does the spiritual say? Sometimes I feel discouraged and feel my works in vain. Douglass rose to his feet and with the brooding melancholy began to speak. What was needed was inspiration. What Douglass was offering was far from that. He continued and spoke of his frustration and sadness. It was then that a sister named Sojourner Truth stood to her feet and interrupted the speech, yelling, "Frederick, is God dead?" That did it for Frederick Douglass. The cloud lifted, the work continued, and in his lifetime, slavery was abolished. At the point of despair, power.